Hello all, welcome to the session wherein we will discuss about basic Linux commands. In this session, we will be using some sample files. You can download the sample files from www.cse.iitb.ac.in/avadhoot. Open your terminal. As we discuss our commands, you can try it on your terminals. We will start our session now. So, well, we will be discussing about basic Linux commands. So this, we have divided this into five things: general purpose utilities, Linux file system, file handling commands, compressing and archiving files, simple filters. So first we will be discussing about general purpose utilities. As I discuss these commands, you can try it on your terminal. So first thing is very simple. We will try it from very simple commands to then we go on to the complex commands. So first command that you will know about is the calendar. So for example, if you want to see any calendar for any month of an year, you can type cal followed by month and year. For example, here cal April 2009, you can see the month of April, and even the date, the current date will be highlighted in that month. And next one is date. Date displays the current date. That means today's date. So when you type just date, then it will be like you will get the today's date in this format. Then there are actually some options which are available so that you can modify how your date looks like. Like the option small d will tell the day of the month, like 1 to 31. Then y, the last two digits of the year. HMS, hour, minute and seconds respectively, and D, the date in that format. So for example, date in the second thing as I have given, so here you can see date plus percentile D percentile H colon percentile M. So this produces that date in this specific format. So for more information you can see man and command name. I'll discuss more about this man command later. Hope that everyone has tried out. With this date command, even you can set your own date, but for this you need privileges. So on the current systems, I don't think that you have the privileges. So if you have root privileges, you can even set the date. That command is same as like date followed by the time you want to set. Then we'll see about echo and printf statements, which will just print the messages that you want to be printed on your terminal. The usage will be echo followed by message within inverted commas. So for example, echo welcome to the workshop, welcome to the workshop will be printed on your terminal. And you can use another print message, another command printf, which is same as C's printf statement mostly. So you can even print the messages on the terminal using this statement. So you can try it out. These are very simple commands. Now we'll see another command for calculator. It's a text-based calculator. You have, I think most of you have used Windows machines which has a graphical user interface, the calculator in a graphical user interface form. Here also in the Linux versions that you have on your desktops, you have GUI calculators, that is Xcalc, but there is another basic text version of calculator called BC. Can type the command BC, and then there will be an empty prompt that will expect an input from you. So you can type this input, which is here, and then the output will be there. So this is a basic small version of text-based calculator. Now we'll see a somewhat more complicated command, which is called script, which is you can record your own session. For example, you have just tried out two or three commands. In future, you will be going to do many other commands. Now you want to save those output and even the commands that you have given to the system in a file. So script command will do that. Script command records your session and stores it in a file. So you can start using command called script, which will display echo a message called script will be started and file is TypeScript. and then you can type any of the commands in this, like echo, this is a sample script session, then it will be echoed, and after till the point you want to just log or come out of the script, type control D, and there will be a message which will be like script done, file is type script. So here when you type just script, it will be like the default file name will be TypeScript, but you can even type script followed by that file name, which will be the commands will be going to be saved on that, in that file. So for example, if the TypeScript file already exists in the directory that you are typing, that will be overwritten, the file will be overwritten, and you can see the TypeScript file, the log file that you have created using script, use by cat TypeScript. We will see about the cat command later, but just use it just to see it what commands you have typed. Now the another important thing, passwd, changing your own password. So for example, on your machine we have set it the password to be 123456. So you can type passwd command to change the password of your system. So it will be asking the current Unix password that you need to type, that is 123456, then the new password that you want to be reflected onto the system, and you have to retype that password, and there will be a message which will say that password updated successfully. The next command that we are going to try out is who. Since Unix is a multi-user environment, many user can log into the system. So if you want to know who are the users currently logged onto your system, you can type command who, which will tell you like which are the users which have been logged into your system. So try it out. I think mostly nobody will be logged into your system, but it will display your own name. Which one? Yeah. So here you can see that on my system there were 4 people who have been logged in. This is the IPs of their machine from which they have logged in under the system. So this is actually when you log into your system, the system will actually create a device file by name pts/0/1/2 assigned to your terminal, so that the file name, I'll talk about it later, but it's just a device file name which is attached to the terminal that the user has logged in. So this is the most important command that we will be using most of the time, the man command. This is a reference manual command. Man displays the documentation for a command. So the syntax will be like man followed by command name. You can type like, for example, man, ls or bc, that the commands that you have tried out. Which one? Sorry? Second field, okay. This one is a date. So that is actually, so when a user will logs into a system, there will be a file which is attached to the terminal that is basically everything will be like files in the Unix. So how the data transfer will takes place between the host system and the remote system, it will be going through that file, device file. So it will be created one, so you have, I think you have, opened as many terminals you have opened, that many files will be created. So if you have opened 2 terminals, there will be 2 files which will be created.
It's used to identify your logins.
Generally, the number of tabs that you open in a terminal also corresponds to the files. So you can type man and command name like bc that you have tried, cal that you have tried, to see the reference manual for that command. We will see this command ls later, but just try it out, the bc and the cal command that you have tried out. So it will be giving you the description. And when you type man and command name, so the reference manual will be huge. So it will be outputting in a page by page format. So to navigate from one page to another, press space bar. And to exit the man page, press Q. So for example, if you want the reference manual for man itself, you can type man command. Man followed by man. You will see the reference manual for man. So these were the general purpose utilities, those are very simple commands. Now we will go to Linux file system. I will explain briefly the Linux file system, and also the commands associated with the file system commands, like we'll be seeing that more. So like in Windows you have seen that the file system is like C, different drives, C drive, D drive, E, F, and for floppy it is A drive, something like that. Now in Linux everything starts from slash, that there is a topmost thing, a topmost directory, then the slash dev will contain all the devices that are accessible as files. So as you have seen like the pts/0, pts/1 in who command, this will be there in slash dev directory. So you can go I will see it later. So all the devices, like if you, for example, if you connect a USB to the machine, so there will be a file created for each device that will be present in slash dev directory. Now slash var is a variable, contains variable data such as mails, log files. For example, let us say that there is a server like Apache's, like the server which hosts a web page. Now the logs for the logs that who have accessed the web page, what is the usernames and password, all will be stored in slash var directory under some other directory. Like if it is Apache, it will be stored in Apache 2, something like that. And /usr will store all the most of the packages which will be installed on your machine, that will be stored in /usr directory. So all the configuration file associated with each and every software that is installed on your system will be present in /etc, and /home will contain the home directories for all the users which are present on the system, which are present in the system. And /root is the home directory for the root user, which is privileged. That means he can install and he can do everything on the system, the root user. /mnt is generally used for mounting other devices. For example, if you want to use your pen drive, or if you want to use your anything, you first need to mount it onto some folder, then you can use it. So these are the things, and so we'll be seeing commands which are used to retrieve the file attributes. First command will be ls. So ls is like listing directory, that is a basic command that mostly you all know. But here if you want to know the permissions for each and every file, then you can type ls space hyphen l command, and you will be knowing. So the basic thing will be, first there will be permissions, owner, group, and the number of bytes, then the modified time, latest modified time, then so on. First the permissions, so you can see drwx r-x. So this is for file, first file, maybe different for your this thing. So here these are 10 characters. The first character, if it is d, it indicates a directory, and if it is dash, it indicates a file. And now remaining 9 characters are grouped into characters of 3-3. So first 3 characters, so you can see that there are only 3 characters which appear in the rest 9 characters, that is R, W, and X. So R is for read, that is file or directory is readable. W is for write, that is file or directory is executable, X is for execute, that is file or directory is executable. Now what does it mean, read, write, and execute? I'll tell you. But what are these 3 groups? So first group corresponds to the owner of the file or the directory. Second 3 characters correspond to the group, permissions for the group. Last 3 characters will correspond to the permissions given to the others. Now basically first, as you can see, first file has the third column here is, which is the owner of this current file. So for this owner, that is Srihari, it has rwx, all the read, write, and execute permissions. And for the group called Srihari, it has read and execute permissions but no write permissions, okay. And for others, other than like the users who belong to other than group Srihari, or if he is not an owner, then he has only read and execute permissions, no write permissions on the directory. Okay, any doubts in this? Yeah, they can be different or they can be same. Yeah, they can. Yeah. So for example, if you can create a group which will be like 4 or 5 users belong to that group, and you can give certain files to that group only, that can also be done. This is a special case that both are same, but it can be different also. So
he doesn't have many logins already. So that's why both the owner and the group is the same.
And one more, how can a directory be executed?
Yeah, I'll come to that. So what does it mean for a directory to be read, write and execute? If a directory is read, then you can read the, so first of all, everything in Unix are files. So even directories are special kinds of files. So if a directory is readable, it means that you can read the contents of the directory. That means what are the files which are present in the directory, you can read them. Write means that you can write in the directory, which means you can create new files in the directory, you can create subdirectories in the directory if you have write permission. And execute means that you can go into the directory, which means you can cd into the directory, you can change your present working directory to that directory. So is it clear or any doubts? No, not clear. Execute is not clear. So when you open your terminal, so it will be the present working directory will be like when you pwd on your terminal, just type pwd on your terminal, that will be your home directory, that is slash home something, and your name will be there or something. So by how can you navigate to other directory is by using command called cd and the directory name. So for example, the directory, if it has a execute permissions, you can cd into the directory. For example, cd dir, if you have execute permissions for dir, then only you can go into the directory and list the file or do anything. If you don't have execute permissions, then you can't go into the directory. Now we'll be seeing how to change the file attributes. Like for example, if you want to as you have already seen, the file has all the 9, 10 characters as like dr dash, then rwx 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 or dashes. If you want to change the permissions, for example, if you want to give the permissions like execute permissions for a particular file, how can you do that? So there are two ways of doing it. The command is actually chmod, which means that change the permissions of the file. So you can actually try it on a sample file that you have. Chmod, first try ls-l on the directory, and if you see that any of the files doesn't have any permissions, you can give the permissions as in like this. So chmod o plus x testing.java means that I am assigning others execute permissions to the others. Now you can see here, by doing ls-l testing.java, I have x to others, which means others can also execute this file. Now you can, for example, if you want to change the permissions for group, then you do chmod g plus, if you want to give write permissions, give w, read r and execute x, and followed by the file name. And this is somewhat cumbersome. The neat way or easiest way of doing this is, so for example, you can change the permissions at a time for all the users, all the like the owner, the group and others, by using this another variant of this command, chmod 655 testing the file name, which means 655 are the permissions for that, you are assigning the permissions for that file name. So 6 means that, so as you have already seen, there are 10 characters, so leave the first character. Now the 9 characters, non-characters are divided into 3 groups, rwx, rwx and rwx. If r is present, give it as 1. So now here, when you see here, RW dash, which means 110, in octal form it will be like 6. Now this is 101, this is 5, 101, which is 5. So you can, if you want to give all the permissions to all the members, then try 777, which gives all the permissions to the all the members. Like anyone can access the file, anyone can delete the file, anyone can execute the file. So after running this command chmod the number and then file name, you can test whether that is reflected in the permissions by typing ls minus l ls space hyphen l followed by the file name that you have changed the permissions. So this number 655 can vary from 000 to 777. 000 means no permissions to anybody, 777 means all permissions to everybody. Is it clear? Anybody has doubts in this? So another thing here, so another if you want to change the another attribute like the owner of the file or the group of the file, then you have to use chown, which means changing the owner of the file. So chown command is used for changing the ownership and also group of the file to which file belongs to. So when you so the syntax is very similar to that of the chmod. The only difference is chown, the username, the user ID for which you want to give the ownership and the file name. So maybe you can't try it on these systems because you don't have privileges or something. So and you can check whether this has been updated by seeing ls minus l the file name. So you can see here that the owner of the file has been changed to guest. Here I have changed the owner of the file testing.java to the guest, and here it has been updated by, you can see by typing ls minus l and the file name. So again this command can also be used to change the group to which the file belongs. So the syntax is pretty similar, chown the user ID colon group ID and the file name. Yeah, so guest user may not be present, so this command may not be executable on all the machines because guest user may not be present. So I think mostly you can't try it on the systems, so just note it down, that's all. So other file system commands are, if you want to delete the file, like delete any of the file that you have, dummy file you have created, so it is rm and file name. And then copying and moving the files, so to copy the file you have to type just cp file name followed by the new file name. It creates a copy for the file name, the original file name. Original file name will be intact. And move is another command which you may not be like familiar in Windows kind of environment, because move is like rename in Windows. So for example, if you want to change the name of certain file, then you have to use move mv command. Mv first the file name followed by new file name that you want to change. So renames the file testing.java to test.java. This move testing.java test.java, it renames the file testing.java to test.java. Now I think yesterday you have seen this how to create the directories by mkdir command. Mkdir followed by the directory name. And for example, if you want to delete the empty directories, then you have to you can use rmdir. So be careful, this rmdir is only used for deleting the empty directories, not the directories which contains files. So if you want to delete the files, delete the directory which contains the files, first you have to go inside the directory, delete all the files, then come back, delete the directory. There is another powerful command for deleting all those things by using rm command. You can delete, but with, you have to use more options that we'll discuss later. So hope that at least other than rm everybody has tried out some commands. So these are the basic Linux file system commands and how to change the permissions and all those things. Now we'll see file handling commands. So first command that we'll see is cat. So for all these, from now onwards, you can use the files which have been, which you have downloaded, and you can like go to that directory, cd to that directory, and use those files for doing this. So cat, first command will be cat, which is used for concatenating files. So cat command is generally used for to display the contents of a small file on the terminal. So the syntax will be cat followed by file name. So for example, cat sample3.txt will display you some lines about Unix operating system or something like that. Cat when followed by one file name, it will display the contents of the file name. So you can supply more than one file name to the cat command. So when you supply more than one file name, what it does is it concatenates the contents of each and every file in the sequence that you have given. Like cat sample3.txt space sample4.txt will concatenate these two files, and it will print echo on the output on the terminal. So you can try the sample like cat sample3.txt space sample4.txt. You will see, and there will be no header information. You can't distinguish between where the file sample3.txt ends and where the sample4.txt begins. So that's why this command is called cat command, because it concatenates different files. So here, instead of 2, you can give n number of files. So it concatenates and throws the output on the terminal. So you can try it out, these commands. Hope that everyone has tried out the cat command. Now we'll come to another command, which is reverse of cat. It is called tack. So as the command states, it does the same thing as it states. Like it, tack command is used to display the contents of the file in reverse order. So when you type tack followed by the file name called sample3.txt, then it will display the sample file, this sample3.txt, in reverse order. So even this command can take more than one file. When supplied with more than one file, what it does is it reverses each and every file and prints those files in the order. Like tack sample3.txt space sample4.txt will first print sample3.txt in reverse order, then print sample4.txt in reverse order without any header information. That means you can't distinguish between after printing, you can't distinguish which portion belongs to which file. So there will be no header information like cat sample 4, which file it belongs or something like that. So you can even try these commands on the sample files which are present.
Lines.
Yeah, lines. So for example, A, then in the next line B, C. If there are only A, B, C in three different lines, then it will print C, B, A.
That means if 10 lines are there, 10th line will become the first line.
Yeah, 10th line will be printed first and then so on. No. It will not change the, it will start from that last line and it will print the whole line in the lines in the reverse order. Hope that this command you have tried out on the sample files. Let us move. Okay, now we'll see the two commands called more and less, which are used as a page for paging. Like for example, as you have already seen, if you type man and followed by command name, man followed by command name, then it will display in the format of like one page at a time. So if you want to, for example, if you want to see a huge file, like there is already one file called sample1.txt, which is very huge. So for that, you can type more sample1.txt. Now it will display the file one page at a time. Then you can navigate from page to page by pressing space bar. And if you want to quit, come out of that command, type Q. So even you can try it out with less sample1.txt. Both are like identical commands. They do the same thing. But less is a standard pager for Linux kind of systems. And in general, the less command is more powerful than more. So yesterday you have seen small vi kind of tutorial. All the vi commands are mostly applicable in less, when you do less followed by file name. but not applicable when you try with more followed by file name. So for example, like more advanced, like searching for a pattern and everything can be easily done in using less command. So it is more powerful than the more command. So you can try it out on your systems. So when you try more and followed by sample1.ext, you will see at the bottom that how much percentage more the text is remaining. And when you type less followed by the file name, you will see how much percentage like less it is remaining, something like that. You can see the statistics below. Hope that this command, these two commands you have tried out. Let us go through one more command, which is wc. So it gives the statistic of a file. For example, if you have a text file, you have many text files like sample 1, sample 2, sample 3. You can try it on many many different files. So wc command is used to count the number of lines present in the file, ASCII file, words, and also the characters, number of characters. So here the word is taken as anything which is delimited by a space. So A space B space C. So A will be taken as a word. In the characters, even space will be considered as one character. And slash n will be considered as one line. So you can type wc sample1.txt, you will get these three statistics: 65 2776 173333, sample1.txt. So first one tells you the number of lines, then number of words, and then number of characters. And if you want to display, only the number of lines or just number of words or just number of characters, you can use the option. So here I would like to tell you that every Unix command will be like this: command followed by options and followed by some file name or some input or something like that. So there will be options for each and every command. So you can try options for this command, which is like for my if you type wc space minus hyphen l followed by file name, it will give only the number of lines which are present in the file. And if you type wc space hyphen w space followed by a file name, it will give you number of words. And similarly for hyphen c, it will give you number of characters. And if you want to see all of them together, just type wc and the file name, that's all. Now this is somewhat important command. This command is used to compare two different files. So for example, if you have two identical files, or for example, if there are two ASCII files, how can you say that both are identical or both are not identical, or where does they differ, something like that. So this command will be useful in telling you which, where, whether they are identical or not. So the usage will be cmp followed by file name, first file name followed by second file name. So it takes two file names for the comparison. And the two files which are given as an input to cmp command will be compared byte by byte, and the location of the first mismatch will be printed. So we can try it out on cmp sample1.txt, sample2.txt. Both are different, so you will get sample1.txt, sample2.txt differ byte 1 comma line 1. So even the line 1 is not same in both. To check whether you will get correct output when you supply both identical identical files to the cmp command, make a copy of sample1.txt as cp sample1.txt space sample1_copy.txt, and then supply this cmp sample1.txt and sample1_copy.txt. Okay, try it out this command: cp sample1.txt, create a copy of sample1.txt, and now give that two files sample1.txt and that copy to the cmp. You'll see that the prompt returns back, which means that there will be no output from the cmp command, which means that both files are identical. We'll take a tea break for 10 minutes and then we'll come back.